When I was a child, we got Scientific American every month and read a lot of the articles in it. But one thing that really fascinated me was this column by Martin Gardner called Mathematical Games that he had every month. And I was really very taken by it. As an undergrad at Caltech, I took a lot of quantum physics. I was either two or three semesters of it. That's because I was thinking of becoming a physics major, but I did not like lab courses enough to do it. So I became a math major instead. But you know, that really, I guess, introduced me to quantum mechanics and got me thinking about quantum mechanics. And when I got to MIT, I took a lot of different courses. I took algorithms and cryptography and number theory. Really, you needed all of these courses to discover the factoring algorithm. So you needed some things from mathematics, some things from computer science, and some things from physics. I was taking courses because I was interested in them, not because I thought they would be ultimately useful for something. Led me to discover this quantum factoring algorithm. The first time I started thinking seriously about quantum computing was after I saw Umesh Bazirani give a talk at Bell Labs. And I started thinking about quantum computing at that time. I didn't tell anybody. And then the next thing that happened was I saw Dan Simon's paper about his algorithm for solving Simon's problem, which is another contrived problem that quantum computers can do faster than classical computers. But this one was really, I want to say this was really kind of like a blueprint for the factoring algorithm. Then figured out how to do Fourier transforms over Z mod P, where P is a smooth number, on a quantum computer. And then I think I got up in the middle of the night and scribbled some stuff down. And that gave me a discrete log algorithm for primes that are one larger, where P minus one is smooth. And so a smooth number is one that has a lot of small factors. So I had a factoring algorithm for smooth numbers. This algorithm was so different from the classical algorithm that I think it encouraged me rather than discouraging me. I played around with it quite a bit more, and I figured out how to use the Fourier transform for P when P was smooth to find the discrete log for any number. I mean, that was great. I could solve something with a quantum computer that you can't solve with a classical computer, and it was, a very important problem because discrete logs are used for crypto systems. I used to work on algorithms for problems in computer science, and now I work on quantum computing. So it's changed direction. I still kept working on traditional computer science algorithms for a few years after the factoring algorithm was discovered, but then I started doing more and more just quantum computing. And I guess the first thing I did after quantum computing was quantum error correction. Without error correction, you can't get very far on a quantum computer. My algorithm has completely changed cryptography because cryptographers now know that the RSA and Diffie-Hellman and the old crypto systems based on discrete log and factoring are not necessarily going to be secure for ever. So they're trying to come up with quantum resistant crypto systems. And this has been an immense area of research. You would really like to make these crypto systems as efficient as possible without, compromising them. And I really don't think they know how to do that yet. So there's going to be a lot more research on these. This is my office. I do a lot of things here. I work with students. I meet students. I work on my computer, writing papers and doing calculations. I'm going to describe the steps in the factoring algorithm. I'm not going to explain why they work because that would take a really long time. But so what do you do? Well, there's a part that you do on a quantum computer, and then there's post-processing that you do on a classical computer. And the factoring algorithm, you want to find P times Q equals N. So you're given N, and you want to find two primes that multiply to N. And start with two quantum registers and these are just basically registers that are superposition of numbers. The first one has 2L qubits and the second one has L qubits, and you start the first register, well, you start them all in say 0. So every qubit is in the state 0. And now what you do is you apply a transformation that takes this state to 1 over 2, 0 plus 1 to the 2L. And now this is the same as summation over I equals 1, 0 through 2 to the 2L minus 1. I with 1 over 2 to the L normalization factor in front of it, 0. Now the next thing you do is you choose a random number X. Well, I choose random X with 0 less than X less than N. And now you compute X to the I mod N in the second register. And now what you do is you take the quantum Fourier transform of the first register and you measure the first register, and this will give you, well, this will give you a number, but the wonderful thing about the number is that you can then take this number and do some post-processing on it. So basically you do continued fraction algorithm and it will give you the factors of N if you're lucky. Do I have any hobbies outside of work? I like writing poetry and I've posted a few of my poems on the web. I like walking, but we have a dog now that I take on walks. Generally every day, she needs like 2 or 3 walks each day. And I like to read a lot. I like science fiction especially, but really I like pretty much any kind of book. I've had a very successful career. Part of its success is that I've chosen some very difficult problems to work on, and I haven't solved anywhere near all of them. Maybe I've solved a third of the really difficult problems that I have worked on. And you know, a third is actually enough. But if I was giving advice to a young researcher, I would say, don't spend 100% of your time working on really difficult problems, because if you don't solve them, which is a very likely thing to happen, then you have nothing to show for your time. But there's always a chance you will solve a really difficult problem, and those are really, you know, good for your career. We keep finding new areas of mathematics that can be used in quantum computing, so don't hesitate to get a really broad background, even if you think it's going to be irrelevant.